This is a real treat for me to do this session because we have one of the most important, I believe, companies in the world that's embracing blockchain. Now, who here was at my opening talk in the morning? Could you put up your hands, please? Okay. So for those that weren't, I sort of shared this odd source of cognitive dissonance for observers of this space, which is that you have a whole bunch of naysayers saying blockchain's kind of petered out and it's dead and it's not happening. And on the other hand, you see these extraordinary implementations involving large organizations like, say, Facebook or China, which is a large organization. And the truth of the matter is we at the Blockchain Research Institute are monitoring hundreds of these actual implementations. And one of the ones that we're most excited about is FedEx. And we're very fortunate to have here today the executive from FedEx who's driving this whole thing, Dale Chrystie, who among other things become a good friend too through our collaborations. So Dale, and by the way, I don't know if we can take questions, but I think we would welcome them. I don't think there's a mic. We could submit it on a piece of paper or something if you want. But I'm going to walk Dale through a bunch of questions that will help you understand what's going on at FedEx and some of the main lessons. Now, this is not about crypto investing. This is about transformation of the enterprise through what I refer to as the second era of the internet. So, Dale, you were in the audience at the opening session of Consensus 2 years ago. And anyone who was there, I gave the opening talk. And then I brought onto the stage Fred Smith, the CEO, founder, really, of FedEx, legendary business leader, and Rob Carter, a legendary CIO. He's been in the job, what, like 20 years or something? CIO is supposed to mean career is over, but Rob sort of defies that acronym well. And it was one of the few times that I've chaired a panel where there were applause in the middle of the panel. There were 3,000 people in the room and another 3,000 outside trying to get in. And Fred said some absolutely extraordinary things about blockchain that kind of stunned the audience. So, Rob, you were out listening to this. Could you give us your recollection of what he said as a way of setting us up?
Yeah, Fred Smith just calmly
said. Did I call you Rod?
You did, but that's okay.
Why do I keep doing that?
It's okay, Bob, I'm gonna call you.
Dale.
Whatever, I'll call you something else. Fred Smith basically came out on stage and said that blockchain is gonna completely change worldwide supply chains. And then he went on to say, if you're not operating at the edge of this technology, you will be disrupted. And he kind of dropped a whole box of microphones at the end in this panel by saying, you know, if you're not really pushing this and embracing all this, you need to be prepared for commoditization or potentially extinction.
So he kind of hedged around a bit on this topic. So this is pretty interesting. So let's explore this opportunity a bit before we get into some of the challenges and leadership issues. Fred started off by saying that we sort of invented the whole idea of the chain of custody of something. And we think that, and he commented on that and the opportunity for FedEx to take a bunch of stuff to the next level. So why don't we start with that, sort of track and trace. And there, well, I'll let you explain your thoughts on that.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, I think a lot of people, if they hear FedEx and they hear blockchain, they automatically go to track and trace. And we would say that we don't think blockchain helps us in the track and trace space at all. Essentially, the point that our chairman made was that not only did we essentially invent the industry, we invented the chain of custody within the industry. And it's what I would refer to as the literal ledger of things. It's millions of packages a day, 15 million packages or something like that. We know where the package is. And so from that point of view, I would, you know, I think of that as the foundational layer. But this, that isn't really helpful from a blockchain point of view. So,
yeah. And that was an extraordinary thing back then. And I wrote this up in 93 in Paradigm Shift, and I interviewed executives at FedEx, and they were delivering millions of packages a day, or this is how it all started. And they had something like a 0.02 failure rate where the package didn't end up on time. And this was just an amazing thing. And Fred Smith was totally unhappy with this because he says, if you do the math, that means that we have thousands of unhappy customers every day. So he moved to this whole chain of custody track and trace thing. So where is the opportunity then for blockchain?
You know, from our point of view, if I think of fingers here, and again, that's my little chart, but right here, the track and trace is the literal ledger of things. It's millions of packages a day. We know where the package is. We don't think blockchain helps us in that space at all. What would sit on top of that essentially is blockchain, which is the virtual ledger of things, which gets you to accuracy and authenticity, and it's essentially a connective tissue. At that point, we see sensor-based logistics, IoT devices and sensors and things like that. And those now give you billions of data points, not millions, but billions of data points, and they not only tell you where your package is, they tell you how your package is. It's at 68 Fahrenheit, it's at 31% humidity, it's been exposed to light, it's been exposed to shock, et cetera, et cetera. And that now really sets up, we think, the opportunity to get to essentially a near real-time supply chain, because now with billions of data points, many of you are out here working on what do you do with all that data and how do you translate data into information and then into intelligence, essentially. So the analytics and the optimization on top of that would get you to essentially a near real-time supply chain. So
okay, well let me just comment on that before you go into the next part. So real-time supply chain, you just kind of throw that out there, but you think about what that means. I mean, you got trains and boats and planes and trucks and escrow agents and shipping companies and borders and transfer authorities and middlemen and clearing and settling and all this stuff is moving around in a fairly primitive way, traditionally, in a supply chain. And we're talking about a sort of non-trivial little industry. It's $50 trillion easily, globally. So imagine having a shared network state that's real time and where you can see what's happening. I mean, that would be an extraordinary thing to me. Why?
It will be. It will be. So again, just to boil it down to a specific example, when you combine all of those things, now if I know where, if my inventory currently is 10 of something because I don't know where all of them are, and if I now know where they all are from an IoT or sensor point of view, I won't need as much inventory. That's going to fundamentally change a lot of business models and what kind of inventory, what kind of production, all the rest of those kinds of things. But it also means that I can also get that in terms of the data and the models that I can lay on top of that. So just one example of that, we have a medical device company that's a big customer in Memphis. And when the polar vortex hit Chicago last winter, a future version of that would be all of their models that not only tell them where their inventory is, where their sensor-based items are, et cetera, they would simply lay the National Weather Service model on top of that and say, okay, well, it's going to hit in 18 hours. We need to move. We know that the model tells us that over a certain amount of snow or below a certain temperature or whatever the case may be, whatever conditions, a certain number of people are going to break their ankle. So they calmly move a certain number of ankle devices into the surgical suite an hour before it fell down. I mean, that's not a perfect world, but that, again, it's just data. I mean, that's all what we're talking about here is just ways to secure and all that from a data point of view. But the data within the supply chain is enormously rich.
And you think about what kind of transactional and management platform you need to track all that data. Ultimately, we're talking about trillions of inert objects that become smart communicating devices. And they're not just communicating, some of them are doing transactions. They're getting themselves cleared at a border, or they're paying a certain duty or something like this. So, I mean, traditional database technology or traditional payments technology, that's not gonna go through Visa, I don't think, as a platform for that. So why blockchain?
Well, at this point, the global supply chain is, I don't know, tens of thousands of companies, all the way down to a bike messenger. And the data, as we all know in the other angles of blockchain, the databases don't talk, different languages, yeah. different everything from that yeah. point of view. We believe that on a global basis, we could get to a common language and a secure chain of custody, and that becomes a very interesting conversation.
Okay. So, big opportunity here. Now, you've focused on the logistics part of the business. FedEx Logistic, is it a separate company?
It's a separate.
It's an operating division.
Yeah, we have operating company. We have carriers, basically.
Yeah.
FedEx Express is the airline. FedEx yeah. Ground yeah. is what you think of for e-commerce. FedEx Freight is heavy freight, yeah. less than truckload. Logistics is a specialty services company that lays over all of those and kind of acts as a conductor, right? A quarterback. That brings all the services together and makes that happen for things like brokerage and all kinds of things.
Okay, and the CEO is Richard Smith. Why start with logistics, or why focus on logistics as opposed to going into one of the subcomponents?
We actually, and since then he's been promoted, by the way. So, I'm sure he would credit you, because after that panel in April, he got promoted. So there it is. We actually didn't start with FedEx Logistics.
Yeah.
We actually did what a lot of people are doing, which is, okay, here's this technology. So what, right? I mean, I've got a slide in my conference material that says blockchain is boring and useless. Yeah. People are trying to sprinkle a little blockchain dust on everything, and it's yeah. going to grow 6 feet tall. Well, in this case, we don't think so. But it's not very fast, it's not very scalable, it's not very mature yet. But what it does really well. And so
yeah.
where we get to authenticity, provenance, we think it becomes important. So we narrowed it down to that. That gets you to things like global clearance. That gets you to things like healthcare, pharmaceuticals, med devices. That gets you to aerospace, aircraft parts, additive manufacturing. Most of those happen to go through FedEx Logistics. So we got to that point through logic and not just let's anoint somebody and let's go take it out for a test drive and see how it works.
Okay, so this is an extraordinary vision and you're into executing. And you've come up with some equally extraordinary conclusions about how to make it work. So I'll just set that up. The panel discussion that you're referring to was April 22nd in Toronto, and our institute held a big event called Blockchain Revolution Global. It's blockchain for the enterprise. 150 speakers, people from 20 countries. It was sort of a big deal for me. And in an opening session, we had Richard Smith, who was then the CEO of FedEx Logistics, and Rob Carter. And I was interviewing them, and Richard said an amazing thing. He said, or no, it was Rob who said an amazing thing. He said, you know, we could just build this whole thing out, and as we did before, stick a FedEx logo on it, try and bring it to market, and we've come to the conclusion that that would fail. Because we're not just changing our own company, we're changing a whole industry. And, let's just stop there and get your thoughts on that or comments on that. How did you come to a conclusion? What does that mean? How do you change a whole industry? Your industry includes people like your competitors, doesn't it?
It does, yeah, that's exactly right. There's a fork in the road here. Blockchain's a technology discussion, but it's not only a technology discussion. And so certainly the technology is gonna have to happen. It's not yet very mature, fast, or scalable, et cetera, and that's its own path, and we're okay with all of that. But the other side of that is that we actually don't think the consortium model will scale. And we worked kind of deeply to get to that point. And just a practical example is that Don and I and two other people up here in the chairs all decide we want to create a little consortia, much like the internet at the time. A few of us get together, if we have an idea, we get a little money, we can build it, get a few customers. And then, so we walk out and we leave the legal folks there to talk about it, and they'll work through it. Oh, Don doesn't want this, Dale doesn't want that, here's this and this. They finally get to a document, and we all come back and sign it, and we go from there. And then we say, wait a second, let's bring Betty in here too. So now we've got a fifth person or a sixth or whatever the case may be. And every time we do that, in a practical sense, we've got to essentially start all over again with that document. If by comparison, you could simply walk in to the room with a an Apache license or an MIT or some equivalent open license on the table and say, first of all, if you come into the room, if you can work with that, it just scaled globally. And so from that, the conclusion was, while we've done that almost exclusively for 45 years, you know, put a bunch of smart people in the room and, you know, keep the doors closed, and when they figure it out, come out and slap a logo on that. Rob said a very extraordinary thing, which is, in this case, we actually think open is the answer, and we don't think we can put a FedEx logo on the side of this and have the world come to us. We don't think that we could put it out and have our competitors pay us for use of that or vice versa. And that really broadened our perspective on that, and that led us down this path. And I'll turn it back over to you, because I could keep going, but anyway.
Well, it led to an extraordinary panel a couple hours later, where I had Dale, an executive from UPS, and an executive from DHL on the stage. Now, normally these people want to kill each other on a typical day, and there they were talking about how they're going to work together to rebuild the logistics industry around blockchain. So what's with that? Why did you think that had to be done? And tell us a bit about that experience. Must be weird.
It's amazing. I mean, you know, my son's a U.S. history buff, and he says, Dad, you're sitting at the table at the Constitutional Convention. And so for, you know, history buffs, that means something, and I appreciated his comment on that. What very few people know is that we are actually part of the same trade association called the Global Express Association, FedEx, UPS, and DHL. And so I get to a word called that I refer to as coopetition. I didn't invent the word, but I'm using it heavily at this point in time because I think it really speaks to that. And the point here is it's not about where we compete. It's about where we can agree. And so where FedEx, UPS, and DHL can agree is that if we can reduce friction across borders, friction in this case means delays, documents, it's a lot of time and effort and energy and resources just to get things across borders. If we can reduce friction across borders, we all win, and our customers win, and global trade also wins. And so with that in mind, the three of us are actually working our way through a position paper that is going to be pushed to the World Customs Organization. Again, where can we agree? We actually believe that by working together, this helps everybody, and it's not a branded thing at all. This tens of thousands of companies across the global supply chain, it's gonna have to work for everybody. It can't just work for one or the other or some small group.
So this is the rising tide lifts all boats idea. So where can you work together, or where do you need to work together?
Well, I mean,
we're a couple of examples.
Yeah, here's one example. We're founding members of the Blockchain Research Institute in Toronto, and that's been a fantastic experience, great networking. There's my plug for that, and we're talking about maybe the possibility of expanding that into the U.S., somewhere maybe around Memphis. So details to follow on that. We'll see if we can figure that one out. But FedEx is also a founding member of the Blockchain and Transport Alliance. And we are working on open, royalty-free data standards in the supply chain space. And I am the chairman of the Standards Council. Also on that council is UPS, Salesforce, Daimler, a number of others. And again, where can we agree? We can agree that we both deliver, or all of us deliver to a zip code, or we all deliver to 123 Main Street. That's not proprietary, it's not antitrust. Certainly, we start every meeting with an antitrust statement, but very quickly we get into, okay, that's a zip code. Well, we use it to use it. Okay, great, there's a data element. And so we're trying to work our way through that from that point of view. So, I mean, it's not unusual for people to talk about things like safety or something like that. We actually think that this piece will actually be non-competitive technology.
Yeah. And this, when you think about it historically, this is not a completely unusual thing. It's just weird for you to be working with your competitors. But you think about the computer industry. Let me editorialize here. When I got going back in the late 70s, computer companies competed based on their own proprietary operating systems. You know, IBM had VMS and MVS, and Digital Equipment Corporation had theirs. And your applications only ran on that platform. Back then, I used to call it the hotel proprietary. You can check out anytime you like, but you can never leave. Because the cost of leaving of moving your applications to another environment was called doing a conversion. And I don't know if there's anyone old enough, maybe you are, Dale, in this room, to know what a terrifying thing that is. It's like 2 years of terrible, difficult work, and the end result is no change in the functionality of what you're building. So now the computer industry has adopted a common platform, which is Linux, and they compete on a higher level, which is actually a better level to compete on because it's closer to creating real value for customers.
That's right. Let me offer, if I could, a good example of that outside of our industry. Earlier this year, it was an extraordinary press release from the CEOs, essentially, of the big three German automakers, Daimler, BMW, and Volkswagen, with Porsche and others as well. And their statement basically said that the future of German automobiles is electric. And that may have passed over the headlines and not gotten anybody's attention from that point of view. But what they were really saying is they're not going to fight over the foundational technology. The Linux example of that, or the Android, if it's a Samsung phone, they're not going to fight over that. You know, the gas pump slot now is universal. Same thing with charging. I'll still compete against him with models, and he'll compete with whatever the case may be. But that's a fantastic example of co-opetition. Fight it out where you need to fight it out, but there are things that are common, and again, where can we agree?
So, and I'm not asking you to give away any confidential information, but can you sort of envisage how this might work? Like, are you, all these companies building a logistics blockchain? Are you going to create a bunch of standards so that blockchains can interoperate to do logistics?
Well, again, if my comment has already been that we don't think the consortium model works, a couple of visuals, if you will. You know, you can pull out your phone or you can look at a touch screen, and right now, most people would kind of crank the microscope down. They would put their fingers together initially and zoom, right? They'd go deeper. And I think a lot of people in this space are looking at that. They're really looking like at the microscopic level. We actually think in a case like this that it's easier actually to pull back from that, to pinch, in other words, and to pull back up. And so we go to 200 plus countries. And so one of my luxuries is that it's not the two of us and two other people in a startup somewhere trying to do that. Our default position from a FedEx point of view is essentially the International Space Station. So when we pull back and look at that and say, here's what this is gonna have to do at a global level, we think it actually clarifies some of the opportunities out there rather than the opposite, where everybody's so cranked down on that they're only seeing a little piece of that.
Okay. So I'd like to wrap up with this idea of leadership. Now, we've kind of been talking about it in some ways. And this morning, I made the case that in this complicated world that we have, you get a crisis of leadership when there's a new paradigm, because vested interests fight against change. Leaders of old paradigms have great difficulty embracing the new. And it has been forever thus throughout history. And I argued that leadership is kind of everybody's opportunity, because the person at the top can't typically learn for the organization as a whole anymore. Things are just becoming too complicated. Now, having said that, that view is kind of obviated by Fred Smith, who's one of the greatest business leaders probably ever. He's created this extraordinary company, and he's someone with enormous curiosity who's driving. But in fact, my experience with him is he's driving all you guys to get on top of this. But within that, you get people like you that rise up and decide, no, this is a big opportunity, and I can be a leader for change. And I think that in most companies, it's not the CEO that's going to be driving this, at least initially. It's just going to happen from various places. So could you talk about how it's happening at FedEx and how different people are getting engaged and coming up with an awakening, really, that there's a historic opportunity as big as the creation of the company in the first place, and maybe bigger?
Yeah, I mean, I'm a former strategy officer, and one of the comments I make in my conference material right now is that if you can align with the corner office, with the C-suite, your chances of success are much better. Doesn't mean that if you aren't aligned that you won't be successful, but certainly I start my presentation with one of the quotes that we started with as well. If I've got an iconic leader like Fred Smith, who 2 years ago was fluent enough in this space to calmly just say it's going to completely change worldwide supply chains and talking about commoditization and extinction, certainly that casts an enormous shadow. And that opens us up to do that. So
it gives you a license, really, to operate and to do stuff.
You said, he's the one that's been saying, when are we going to do this? What are we going to do? What is obvious to him is not obvious to many people.
Yeah.
And this was yet another example of that from that point of view. And so part of the, again, part of its technology, part of its thought leadership, part of the point is to get that out. In a conference material, I would tell you that if this co-opetition concept is out there, it's going to take all of us in the audience and anybody who's listening to this to work together. It's essentially a team building exercise to do that. And so, you know, it takes a long time to get a Rob Carter, a Fred Smith, the legal department, everybody else to go, oh wait, open is inevitable. But once you're there, how soon can we get it to everyone else? Because if you think of the trajectory of each of us doing this by ourselves, then it's a slow trajectory. If we can work together to expand this thing, that actually changes the trajectory, changes how quickly this will scale to the benefit of all. So it's not an altruistic thing for us to do that. We just don't think we can skip this step. And with a leadership team like we have, they get it, they understand it, and we're out talking about it.
So what advice would you give to people in an organization where they don't have a Fred Smith and where they're buried and working away and they have this vision on how the company can change? How can they become influential? How can they build up the groundswell to start to make it happen?
Well, a single evangelist is going to have a big challenge no matter what, right? And so, use cases are important, the global clearance and some of those kinds of things that are important to talk about, but it's also important for the C-suite to understand blockchain. And smart contracts is a great way to talk about that. If you can find a way to get to that point, give them practical reasons. I mean, the CFO, I was on the flight with the CFO, and if he's tasked with reducing accounts receivable, then a smart contract that would allow you and I to negotiate that, and once I've done my two-day delivery and I've kept it within the right temperature range and the humidity range, et cetera, if, then you will pay me, becomes an instant payment, right? I mean, this audience understands that whole concept. That gets you to the CFO. Now they're interested. You've got their rapt attention. CIO's going to need people to code that. The chief legal officer is going to need bilingual attorneys who can read not only a paper contract but also a smart contract. Your chief HR officer, if peer-to-peer technology means that if you and I can find each other in a trusted environment, we can do so, isn't going to need recruiters, isn't going to need a lot of these other things that are now part of that. Now you're most of the way around the C-suite, and it becomes practical. It's not a, let me learn this new language that's kind of Greek and I never practice it. This is what they're hired to do. They're hired to manage risk and to look at opportunities, and this becomes very transformative technology. Fred Smith said it, ignore this at your own peril. At commoditization or extinction, and if many companies sit between supply and demand, right? It's an algorithm, you could get ride sharing, you could get a guest house, you could get stuff you have in your attic. It's all a lot of stuff that sits between supply and demand, but everybody else is gonna have the same thoughts that we do. It's not like we've cornered this thing. The sooner you get this and understand this, the better, and if you can translate that evangelist into that type of practical business language, now you're not trying to convince them of the inherent goodness of something. It's actually a risk and an opportunity for them in their C-suite position.
Nice. I think a lot of the time when these radical new paradigms in technology come along, the internet of information, or computing originally, the natural tendency for a business is, well, we need to have a business case. And so the advocates perform a cost benefit analysis to show why this is something we should be doing. I got to think doing a cost-benefit analysis for why we ought to transform the entire logistics industry, that might be kind of challenging. And I actually came up with these laws around cost-benefit analysis. A couple of more that, to relate to your thing about getting the corner office on board, is the probability of your business case succeeding is directly proportionate to the degree to which the CEO thought it was a good idea anyway. And so you can have the tightest little business case in the world, but if the CEO thinks blockchain is that's what criminals use or something, you'll get nowhere. And then there's, I called it the Bob Dylan law. And I think that this is, in part, is what Fred has applied, which is that you don't need a weatherman to know which way the wind blows. You know, that it's like in the early days of the internet. We cost justified that, and we're going to save paper or have fewer printers. That's how email was cost justified. And we find these little things that we can measure to try and build a business case for things which are much harder harder to measure. So how's that been going on at FedEx? I mean, do you have a tight little business case on why you should go about doing all of this?
Well, I mean, I've mentioned global clearance a couple of times. We think the government has to be involved. You know, we've privately and then publicly challenged U.S. Customs and Border Protection to simply mandate blockchain out on the horizon, plant a flag 5 years out or something, and let us all work toward getting there. We've done a couple of proofs of concept.
Do you want to repeat that for the journalists in the audience? FedEx is challenging U.S. Customs and Border Protection to mandate blockchain.
Plant a flag out there on the horizon and let us all go and figure out a way to do that. Again, that puts our money where our mouth is, which is we don't think we can, we can't do it by ourselves, we can't wait for them to do it, and we can't wait for others to do it. To us, the logical conclusion becomes just mandate it. Let's work together. We've done a couple of proofs of concept with Customs and Border Protection. They get it. They have a wonderful 21st century vision of where this is going to go. I mean, data knows no geographic borders. Right? We in this room, we get that. We understand that. That's not a radical concept. It's just not the way the processes are currently set up with a lot of the how do you get across the border and what's going on. But if we could create a single data line, this data standard and this technology over the top of that, it doesn't have to have the level of friction and delay and cost and everything else to that, especially in a world of e-commerce where we all want it quicker and quicker and quicker and quicker. We're really pushing the behind the scenes of how fast we can do those things that weren't ever designed to do that in the first place. We're also part of an FDA pilot. They get it, they understand it, and we work very closely with all of them, and we're gonna have to.
Final suggestions. Enterprise advocates, they wanna get this going in the firm. Advice, what should they do?
Let me know, right? I mean, we're talking about working together. We got to work together. So Blockchain and Transport Alliance is a pretty low barrier to entry from that point of view. We're working our way through the creation of open and royalty-free data standards in this space. Certainly, we believe that it's going to take a big global village to build it. If you start hearing about something like that, come join us. So,
terrific. Well, we start off this morning with some comments from pundits about how blockchain is not happening and it's petered out. Exhibit A on why that is factually incorrect, FedEx. So count it. Thanks, Dill. Thank you so much.
Thank you.